Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for coming out tonight for our edition, this month's edition, November edition of the 2010 Von Kármán Lecture Series. As many of you may know, we do have the 2011 schedules available out there on the little desk on your way out to the left, okay? So feel free to grab those. So, peering down through the clouds and deep into Jupiter's atmosphere, the Juno mission should reveal fundamental processes of the formation and early evolution of our solar system. Scheduled to launch in August 2011, the solar-powered spinning spacecraft will fly in a highly elliptical polar orbit, skimming within 3,000 miles of the cloud tops, and will avoid Jupiter's highest radiation regions. Juno's scientific payload includes a dual-frequency gravity radio science system, a 6-wavelength microwave radiometer for atmospheric sounding and composition, a dual-technique magnetometer, plasma detectors, energy particle detectors, a radio plasma wave experiment, an ultraviolet imager spectrometer, and a color camera to provide the public with their first glimpse of Jupiter's poles. Tonight's guest started his career in the space business as a student controller for the Solar Mesosphere Explorer mission at the University of Colorado Boulder Laboratory for Atmospheric and Space Physics in 1982. Coming to JPL in 1985, he became a trajectory engineer for the Voyager encounters at both Uranus and Neptune. He then created advanced concepts and managed mission design software development for several years. After that, he joined the Mars program, where he was the deputy of Mars Advanced Studies. In the last 15 years, he's led numerous mission proposals for Earth and deep space missions, and in 2003, he became the proposal manager for Juno, and continued with the mission as the mission operations manager until just recently, when he was appointed JPL Advanced Concept Development Manager. Still, he insists he won't grow a beard, even though he feels like a grandfather of Juno. And he's most grateful that he's had the honor of working with many wonderful and dedicated JPL and NASA scientists and engineers over the years. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming tonight's guest, Dr. Steve Matuszek.
Welcome in, buddy. Thanks, Mark. Good evening. And also thanks to all of you for joining me on this Odyssey to Jupiter, and we'll see it through the eyes of the next mission to Jupiter, Juno. I also wanted to thank you especially because it's been pretty windy, and I'm glad you all made it here tonight. On a personal note, I wanted to thank the hundreds of scientists and engineers that have been working on Juno to date to build, test, and then after launch will operate the mission. I think it's going to be a fantastic mission, and I'll tell you about that as we go through the slides tonight. First of all, before I talk about the history of Jupiter and Jovian exploration, on a personal note, I started this odyssey, I call it, back in 2003 when Scott Bolton, the principal investigator, knocked on my door and said, Steve, would you like to be the proposal manager for Juno? And at that time, I had no idea, it wasn't in my wildest dreams, how exciting this journey has been. So first of all, though, I wanted to talk about Jupiter. Of course, many of you can see Jupiter in the night sky now. If you walk outside, you can see Jupiter. It's the second brightest thing other than the moon out there. If you take your telescope or borrow one and look at it, it's really an outstanding view. And Jupiter was seen by the ancients all the way back for thousands and thousands of years. I get many questions about what does Juno stand for? Well, Juno is not an acronym. Juno is the wife of Jupiter in Greek and Roman mythology. And Juno was, well, Jupiter, of course, had, in mythology, took the clouds and surrounded himself with the clouds so he could hide himself. And Juno, his wife, could peer through the clouds to see Jupiter. And that's where we came up with the name Juno. So I slipped in a sky chart here right at about now. If you walk outside, you'll see Jupiter. You face the south, and it's right there. So after the talk, you can walk outside and anywhere in LA, even in bright places that have a lot of light, you can still see it out there. So a bit of history before we talk about the Juno mission. Of course, Galileo, 400 years ago, with the first telescope, one of the first objects that he pointed his telescope at was Jupiter. And what he saw, you can see sketched out here, out of an excerpt from one of his early notebooks, and you see Jupiter, and then he saw four points of light around Jupiter. Those are the Galilean satellites, which astonished him, and it actually astonishes me today, even when I look at Jupiter through a telescope. And here is a typical picture of what you can see through your telescope from the ground here. Other early observations over hundreds of years, people made better telescopes, and they could look at Jupiter, and they would sketch in their books what they saw. And they saw tantalizing details of Jupiter. They weren't quite sure what they were, but they could see features that would repeat. And that was the first time they could determine that Jupiter had about a 10-hour day as compared to the Earth's 24-hour day. So Jupiter's spinning about 2.5 times faster than the Earth. Oh, sorry, I'll back up. Another thing you tell from this is it looks like there's banding on Jupiter, and I'll touch on that later on, so remember that part of Jupiter. Now, I wanted to point out where Jupiter is in the solar system, of course. This is not to scale other than the size of each one of the planets. Of course, we have the Sun on the left, and then the rocky inner planets, of which the third one there from the Sun is the Earth, then Mars, then we get to Jupiter, the largest planet in the solar system and the largest of the gaseous outer giant planets, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. Now, if we zoom in a bit on the four gaseous giants, you see that Jupiter is the biggest planet. In fact, it's so large that if you added the mass of all the other planets together, you still don't get up to the mass of Jupiter. Saturn, of course, has its ring system, and then Uranus and Neptune are smaller cousins. Now, I'm not going to be talking about the other gaseous giant planets tonight, but I wanted everyone to note that they are there, and they are all composed of hydrogen and helium, mostly. And so they're all brothers and sisters in the planetary family there. So when we find out things about Jupiter, we can apply some of those to the other gaseous giants and understand them. So how big is Jupiter? I've given some data about it. You can fit 11 Earths across the diameter of Jupiter, and it's over 300 times the size of the Earth. So if you were standing, if you could stand on the surface, which you can't because it's made of clouds, but if you could, and you weighed 100 pounds here on the Earth, you would weigh 250 pounds on Jupiter. So it has an immense gravitational field. Now, zooming in closer, I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about the Galilean satellites a little bit. On the left, we see the great red spot. So this is a zoomed-in picture of the red spot. And again, not to scale, we took the best pictures of each one of the Galileans and moved them in there. And the great red spot is about the size of the Earth. And the other Galilean satellites are almost as big as the Earth. We have Io, which is the closest one, which Io has gigantic volcanoes and is continually spewing out material because of the immense gravitational forces of Jupiter is stretching and pulling Io. Then there's Europa, which probably has an ocean underneath. Then we get to Ganymede, the largest moon in the solar system, and Callisto. And those are the four satellites that I talked about earlier that Galileo saw. Also in the upper right, many people think of Saturn as having the rings in the solar system, but Jupiter has rings also. They're not very, you can't see them with the naked eye, but when missions have flown by, you can see that there's rings there, and there's some shepherding moons that are there. And I picked five of the larger moons in the lower right. People ask me, well, how many moons does Jupiter have? It depends on how you count and what type of objects you count, but the latest number I've seen is 63. I know Saturn and Jupiter are in a contest to see who has the most number of moons, and they're discovered all the time. They have very irregular shapes there. So I wanted to provide this as a background for Jupiter. Now, the Juno mission is not going to be studying any of the moons of Jupiter, and I'll tell you why when we get into the project itself and what the mission wants to do. So why do we want to send Juno to Jupiter? We've had other missions that have gone to Jupiter, but there's still major things that we don't know about Jupiter. Now let me talk about those a little bit. The first one is, how did Jupiter form? If we understand how Jupiter formed, remember I said that Jupiter has the most mass by far of any of the planets in the solar system. If we understand how Jupiter formed, we understand more about how all the planets formed, including the Earth. These days, I see headlines a lot in the newspapers about another planet has been discovered on a star outside of our solar system. And so a big question is, do those other solar systems look like ours? Do they not? And by studying Jupiter, we learn how our solar system was formed, because that's the closest system we have to look at, and we understand how the Earth was formed. So that's one of the big questions that we're going back to Jupiter for. Another big question is, what's in the interior of Jupiter? We don't know. We think that there's a core, but what's the core made out of? Is it rocky? Is it not rocky? What and the intense pressure and temperature in the inside of Jupiter, what is it made out of? It could be a material called metallic hydrogen, which is a very exotic material that happens when you get to millions of times the pressure that we have on the surface of the Earth and the temperature in the interior. We want to know that, because once we know what's in the interior of Jupiter, we understand what's in the interior of the other outer gaseous planets too. I mentioned, do we even know if there's a solid core? When I talk about the Juno mission, I'll describe how we'll be able to determine if there's a solid core and what's it made out of. Now I wanted to show a couple of animations here. Another thing that we want to determine is how far down do these features that you can see here of Jupiter, the bands that go back and forth like this, and the red spot and the other storms that are on Jupiter, how far down do they go? We don't know if they go a long way down or if just it's the very top part of it. So in this animation from the Cassini mission that flew by Jupiter, you can see that these bands are moving at different speeds. Let me play it one more time, because that goes by pretty quick. You see there's the different bands, and the winds in some of these bands can go up to 300 miles per hour. So if you thought the winds tonight were pretty high, they would. This is more than a tornado on Jupiter. Now another view that we have of this, that Juno's going to fly over the poles, and I'll talk more about that later too, but Cassini could look at the poles. So we're looking straight at the South Pole here, and so this is the south polar region of Jupiter, and you see that that the center part of it doesn't move very much. They move pretty slowly, while the rest of it here is spinning around very quickly at about 10 hours per revolution. So why is that? Why does Jupiter have a region here that's barely moving and the outer part is moving very quickly, and why does it look like bands? All those basic questions we need to understand. There's different models that scientists have of why Jupiter looks like that, but when we get the measurements back from Juno, we'll be able to figure that out. Another aspect of Jupiter that is fascinating is Jupiter has a gigantic magnetic field. It's the largest structure in the solar system. And we know that because we can see at the pole that the magnetic field accelerates particles and they slam into the atmosphere and they create aurora. Those aurora are like on the Earth, where if you've ever been up north or seen pictures, there's the aurora borealis, where the lights are flickering. And so that's Earth's magnetic field and particles, mainly electrons, hitting the atmosphere and creating the light show. Well, at Jupiter, the light show is much larger than on the Earth. In fact, this picture seen from the Hubble Space Telescope in ultraviolet it'd take five Earths to fit in the size of their northern lights there. And some other intriguing things about this region are, you see the satellites, Io, Ganymede, and Europa, as they go around in their orbits, you can see traces of where they're at in the aurora. Why is that? What is causing all these features to happen in the aurora, and what do they look like? Juno will be flying right over these regions and straight through them and determining what is in that region. Now, I've talked about the magnetic field, and so I wanted to show you as Jupiter rotates, what does the magnetic field look like? Because it's hard to imagine what a magnetic field looks like. Sometimes if you've taken a bar magnet and you put iron shavings on there, you see these lines that get, the magnetic field lines that get traced out. Well, on Jupiter, as it's rotating at 10 hours per revolution, the entire magnetic field is also rotating at 10 hours per revolution. And it's not symmetric. If you look at it, it's offset. The first view you saw was from the equator. Now we're looking from the pole. And so that magnetic field is offset, and it's a very complex system. And so Juno's gonna fly right through that, and so we can understand what is creating the magnetic field and why it looks the way it looks. Another major question that is really a dilemma is, where is the water at Jupiter? As we go from the inner part of the solar system to the outer part of the solar system, of course, the Earth has a lot of water. And the Galileo mission had a probe that went down into the atmosphere of Jupiter. The probe had a parachute, and for about an hour, it returned measurements. And everyone predicted that the probe would find water, water vapor, water clouds. And the probe did not find any water clouds or any water. Why is that? There's got to be water clouds there, and there's not. So Juno will go and look across the entire globe and find out, did the probe go into a desert up in the sky or at Jupiter? Or is it all the way around the planet and there's not really much water there? The reason I'm emphasizing water is, if you understand where the water is now in the solar system, you can figure out clues about how the solar system formed again. There's comets, there's water at the Earth and other bodies, and understanding where this water is when it's frozen, we can get clues about, did Jupiter form close to the Sun? Did it form further out? Did it form where it is right now? All these things are clues about our solar system. So Juno will answer all of these questions, and if, as scientific exploration goes, if it answers a question, it will certainly raise other questions for future missions to be able to answer. Now, where does Juno fit into all of the Jupiter exploration that's gone on? Well, back in the 1970s, the first flybys of Jupiter happened. That was with the Pioneer missions, Pioneer 10 and 11, and those flybys returned data where we found out that the more details about the bands and got pictures of the satellites. Then, of course, Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 both flew by Jupiter, again returning more data about the system, about Jupiter and all the satellites, discovering that on Io there was huge volcanoes that are continually spewing sulfur out, for example. Then the Ulysses mission did a flyby so that it could go to the poles of the sun and figure out what the polar regions of the sun looked like. In between Ulysses flybys there was a Cassini mission that flew by Jupiter in order to get out to Saturn, and I showed those movies earlier from Cassini, so Cassini did a lot of imaging of Jupiter. And then, of course, the first orbiting mission, there was the Galileo mission that spent years orbiting Jupiter. Now, it's important to note that the Galileo mission was in the equator of Jupiter and did many flybys of the Galilean satellites. It had spectacular images. I picked some of the best ones to show earlier. But none of these missions have gone over the poles to look at what's at the polar regions of Jupiter. So Juno, and I'll show you how Juno does this in a little bit, is going to go over the poles, and it will get closer to Jupiter than any other previous mission. In fact, it gets so close, it's the distance between LA and New York, about 3,000 miles is how close we are above the cloud tops. And then, of course, in the future, there's a Europa Orbiter mission planned to go to Jupiter. So that's where Juno fits in all of the Jovian exploration that's going on. So now I will talk about the Juno project in particular. Juno is the first solar-powered mission to Jupiter. We're extending the capability to go out as far as Jupiter with solar power. There's 8 science instruments, and I'll go through in detail those, and we have a visible camera also that'll return pictures. Now, Juno is a spinning spacecraft. So if you look at the spacecraft here, it's spinning the entire mission. And when I talk about the spacecraft, I'll tell you how we're able to do that and why we spin the spacecraft. It takes a long time to get out to Jupiter also. It takes 5 years, and then we spend 1 year at Jupiter. Before I talk about the science instruments, I wanted to talk a bit more about how, when you're investigating someplace, how do you look at it? There are many ways to see Jupiter. You can see it with the naked eye. You can go outside and you see Jupiter up in the sky. You can look at it from the ground with telescopes, again, with invisible light. There's the other ways you can look at it are in ultraviolet light, and that way you see the aurora and some other features. You can look at it in the infrared. You can look at it in microwaves and in radio waves. So all these ways are useful, and Juno does some of those ways of looking at Jupiter. Let me try and explain this again here, because imagine that you have your senses to look at and understand rain. Now, in this case, I'm using rain like Jupiter. You can feel the raindrops, you can see the raindrops, you hear thunder, you see lightning, and so you have your senses. Well, we can't do that at Jupiter because we can't send people there. So we're sending instruments that look at different Jupiter in different ways to sense if there's water there, to sense what's in the core. So now I'll talk about the particular instruments of Juno. The first instrument, it uses the telecommunications subsystem. This consists of the high-gain antenna here that sends back the telemetry and the radio waves. And we can measure very precisely the Doppler shift. When we get close to Jupiter, the Doppler shift is like if you're listening to a car or a train and you hear the go by, we're measuring that. And when you can measure those Doppler shifts, you can tell what's in the inside of Jupiter and what's causing the spacecraft to speed up and slow down. And then when you get those measurements back, you can put that into models and figure out what the core's made out of and where the masses are in the interior of Jupiter. I mentioned that Jupiter has the largest structure in the solar system, the magnetosphere. We're sending the magnetometer instrument there to measure the magnetic fields. And the magnetometer is out on a boom that's as far from the electronics in the center part of the spacecraft here as we can get it, because you want to measure the magnetic field of Jupiter and not of the electronics on the mission. Many missions that have had magnetometers, in fact, the Voyager spacecraft here in von Kármán, Cassini, you put the magnetometers way out on the end, and Juno's no different in doing that. It has this interesting shape here because even the materials, the measurements are so precise that even the materials that are close to the magnetometer here, they have to pay careful attention to. And another thing, for example, is on the solar arrays here, they have to backwire those and make sure that the wires all cancel out the magnetic fields, because when you have electrons moving back and forth through wires, it creates a magnetic field. So they very carefully are wiring those both ways to cancel out the magnetic fields. Then there's the microwave radiometer, which is really, it's six instruments in one. It's looking at six microwave frequencies, and what it's measuring is Jupiter gives off microwaves, and those microwaves come from different depths. It's emissions from the planet. And so at those six frequencies, you can look and see where the water is at what depth at Jupiter. And so that's what the microwave radiometer does. Six instruments in one. Then there's a suite of instruments to look at the polar regions, the magnetosphere, and see what's going on in those auroras, what particles are going through there. We know there's electrons and ions, but what do they consist of? How much energy are they putting into those north and south polar regions? That's the Jedi, Jade, and Waves experiment. There's an ultraviolet spectrometer that looks at the polar regions in ultraviolet. Remember I showed that was another way you can look at Jupiter and see things differently. And there's an infrared spectrometer and camera, and that infrared is another way. So they combine all these measurements and they can understand what's happening in those regions that have not been explored before. And then finally, there's a visible camera that will take pictures when going over the poles, and that visible camera's on there for education and public outreach. For example, some of the pictures that are planned for that camera, students will be involved as Juno gets out to Jupiter in selecting where it should take pictures and in processing the data. To give you an idea about the spacecraft itself, remember I said that Juno is solar powered. Out at Jupiter, it's five times the distance that the Earth is from the Sun. And so the amount of sunlight that you get is 1/25th that we get here on the Earth. So the electronics here in the center part, it takes about 400 watts to power the electronics, the sensors, to keep things warm. In order to get 400 watts, you have to put these large solar arrays on here that are 20 meters from tip to tip. To scale here, this is a person about my height, And so you can imagine how large this is. From the bottom, on the another view of the spacecraft here, from the bottom to the top here is about 15 feet. So I'd have to stand on my shoulders and stand on my shoulders again, and that's how large it is. The reason that Juno is so large in that central part is because in this central part here, there's large propellant tanks. It takes a lot of propellant to get out to Jupiter. I'll explain in a little bit why it takes so much propellant. Down below here also is the main engine that we use to speed up and slow down. And then there's thrusters located in various positions here around the spacecraft. So as Juno is spinning, it's like a gigantic gyroscope. If you've ever done the experiment where you take a bicycle wheel and you spin it up and you try and move it, it's very stable. And so Juno is very stable as it's spinning. It spins between one revolution per minute up to, when we're doing a main engine burn, up to about 10 revolutions per minute. So it's not spinning very fast, but it has a lot of mass there. So it's a gyroscope that's not moving, and that's good, because if you don't do anything to it, it's going to keep spinning and stay in the same orientation that it needs to. So we can go for long periods and not have to do anything to the spacecraft. Another thing you'll see here in the bottom picture, there's two long antennas here that the waves instrument uses to measure the plasma waves, radio and plasma waves that come from the magnetic field. The other instruments are spread out around the spacecraft, and the reason that is that each one of the instruments needs to have its own field of view, the way that it's going to look out, and it needs to be unobstructed. So you'll see that the, for example, JunoCam that takes pictures, it has a field of view that comes out like this, and it's in between the solar arrays, so it's not obstructed by anything. Oh, another question I get is, why are there three solar arrays? Why are there three different sets of panels here? And it turns out that was the best shape to fit in all of the solar cells that need to go on. There was three of these, and the one is slightly different, having a magnetometer boom out here, but the inner part of it is identical to these other parts. So that simplified things also. Now, I wanted to mention that it takes the capabilities of many partners across the United States and even the world. So, for example, of course, JPL here is involved in the mission. Mail and Space Science Systems in San Diego. There's Lockheed Martin in Denver that is putting together integrating the entire spacecraft and the instruments. In fact, it's in the middle of about to go into an environmental test in about a month or so. And also located there is the United Launch Alliance that has the rocket that Juno will launch on. Southwest Research down in San Antonio, Texas. The University of Iowa in the Midwest. Then on the East Coast, there's Goddard Space Flight Center, Applied Physics Lab, and Kennedy Space Center, where we're going to launch from. Internationally, we have the Italian Space Agency that provides the infrared camera, the JIRIM camera, the Danish Technical University that's providing part of the magnetometer instrument, the precise star trackers to know where the magnetometer is in space. And then some of the sensors are also provided by the Belgian Science Policy Office. So it truly is a worldwide effort. Now I wanted to show a few pictures here and start to talk about the mission. Juno is launching on the largest Atlas V rocket that there is. It's called the Atlas V 551. It means that it has five solid boosters down here on the bottom. And this is, imagine that it's the night before August 5th, 2011. This is what it will look like when it's stacked up on the launch vehicle. Juno is way up in the upper part here. And as the rocket launch goes, of course, the solids come off. Then, after the solids come off and the launch vehicle is out of most of the atmosphere, the fairing comes off. And then the rocket keeps thrusting. After the fairing comes off, the upper stage will give us our final boost, the Centaur upper stage, which is over here, right here. And then we're released from the Centaur upper stage, given a slight spin. It's spinning at about a half revolution per minute. After that, the solar arrays start to deploy. Each one of these segments here, there's four segments on these two and three segments here, and that takes a couple minutes until they're fully deployed, and we're spinning about a half RPM. And that all occurs in darkness. Then a few minutes after that, the sun will come up over the horizon and the photons will hit the solar arrays and provide power. And then for the rest of the mission, the Juno will have sun on the solar arrays. So how do we get out to Jupiter? There's several ways you can get out to Jupiter. It turned out, since this was a competed proposal to NASA, we chose to use the largest Atlas V launch vehicle, and also then we go into a two-year orbit after launch here, like this, and then we come by and we get a gravity assist from the Earth. Then we go out to Jupiter. That turned out to be cheaper to do that than to buy a bigger launch vehicle. So launching here, we go out for about a year. So in September 2012 will be the first main engine burn. There'll be two big burns there, which lines us up to go swing by the Earth out here in October 2013. Then a little less than 3 years after that, we end up out at Jupiter, where we do a main engine burn and go into orbit about Jupiter. Another thing to note about this is that we go slightly inside the orbit of the Earth. So there is, during that part of the mission, we keep the high gain pointed at the sun all the time to provide a shade for the electronics that's underneath. Let me talk about that for a second here. The right here you can see one side of the vault. Remember I said there's the magnetic field and there's a lot of particles at Jupiter. So we have to protect the electronics from the particles that are at Jupiter, and we put the electronics inside of a titanium vault. The titanium vault weighs about 250 kilograms and it acts as shielding for all the sensitive electronic parts in there. That's another reason that we could send this mission to Jupiter. So once we're in orbit at Jupiter, which occurs, let me tell you what you're seeing here. This top view, you're seeing a side view in the at the equator of Jupiter, and Jupiter's right here. It's this very small tan-colored thing. These red arcs here are the orbits of the Galilean satellites, and then we have Juno coming in here, and it's about ready to do its main engine burn here. Then it goes into a large orbit of about 107 days. This burn right here happens on July 5th of 2016, and local time, it will happen at about 7:30 p.m. on July 4th. I swear we didn't plan it that way. It just happens to be that way. And that's about the same time that the fireworks are going on at the Rose Bowl. So I look forward to that. That's going to be quite spectacular. Then in orbit at Jupiter, we do another burn here after 107 days, and we're down into 11-day orbit. And down here, you see, this is a view from the North Pole. So if you're above Jupiter at the North Pole and you're looking down, you see that the orbit stays mostly in the same direction, but each one of these, where did my arrow go here? Whoops. I think I just Hang on a second. There we go. Each one of these blue lines here, you can barely see them probably, is a particular orbit. We do 30 science orbits. There's 33 total orbits at Jupiter. And each one of those is 11 days. Now, Jupiter, I told you, has an immense gravitational field. And we know that Jupiter is going to turn the orbit as after each orbit. So that's what you see here in this part right here. I keep losing my pointer. There we go. So the first orbit is here, and the last orbit is down here. And Jupiter turns that orbit down as the mission progresses over the year. Now, one of the things I mentioned that we needed to protect the electronics in the vault from the radiation, and this is a view. Remember I said that the magnetic field is dynamic and it's not symmetric. So what you're looking at here is a view of what the radiation bands look like within the magnetic field. So in the inner part here, there's more radiation, and then as you get to the outer part, there's less particles and less radiation. And the way this looks in a simulation here over a couple of Jovian days, over 20, 24 hours or so, that moves back and forth in time. And so as what you're looking at now is the same radiation region, and that moves slightly as the orbits progress. So this is another view of the first orbit of the mission, 11 days. And you can see that we avoid most of these yellow and red regions, which has the most intense radiation. And then as the mission progresses, halfway through the mission here, we start to hit some of the radiation. And then down near the last orbit, we're hitting some of the more intense radiation areas there. And that's what limits Juno's lifetime, is that we want to maintain control of the mission and return all the science. And once this orbit starts to get down there and we start hitting the radiation, we need to be able to end the mission. We need to be, the Juno needs to be a good citizen of the Jovian system and make sure that we go into Jupiter and not crash into something else. Now, another thing that characteristic of the mission is that we want to create regularly spaced, when we go closest to Jupiter, we want to have those regularly spaced around the planet. And so what you see on the left here is the closest approach portion of that orbit that I showed. The blue tracks here are in the first half of the mission, the first 15 orbits, and the green tracks are in the next 15 orbits. So, for example, I'm just going to show a few orbits here on the right just to show you what happens. You can see a faint trace, maybe not. You can barely see a trace that goes down along here, and it's producing these different parts of the web. And the magnetometer instrument wants those to be equally spaced. So in the first half of the mission, those are spaced 24 degrees apart. Then we do a 12 degree shift halfway through, and the ultimate spacing here is 12 degrees apart. So you have 30 orbits, 12 degrees, 360 degrees. And then we've made a map across the whole globe of Jupiter, which is important when you're trying to understand what is creating the magnetic field. You can then take those measurements and put them into models and understand what is causing the magnetic field and why is it not symmetric. To describe another way, when we're close to Jupiter, here, that's what these tracks are, again, in a piece of the web. The gravitational field, when we're measuring the Doppler shift, we're very close to the planet, and we can tell in these swaths across the whole globe. Juno is looking across the whole globe with the measurements because we want to determine across all of Jupiter what the gravitational field is, and again, for the water properties, Where is the water at Jupiter? And once all those measurements come back, you can look at the maps that come back and see if there's more water in one place than another, or is it all around the whole globe? So as I alluded to earlier, at the end of the mission, which is on this last orbit here, we do a maneuver at the furthest point from Jupiter, and then after that maneuver, we go into Jupiter, into the atmosphere, and it burns up, and that's the end of the mission. And that happens in October 2017. So now, I wanted to put a plug in for Juno has some a new website coming out. Of course, you can go to nasa.gov/Juno and learn about all the details of the mission. In mid-December, there's going to be a new website also coming out, missionjuno.swri.edu, which is going to have even more details of the mission, have pictures of how the spacecraft's being put together and other simulations of the mission. And that website will be updated throughout the entire mission as the Earth flyby occurs and other events during the mission. So I'm very excited to see Juno launch and then get to Jupiter, and I hope you are now too after I've talked about it. I would like to now take questions if people have questions. And thank you for listening about Juno tonight. They asked me to say, if you do have a question, if you could come up to the microphone, that would be great. I know there's a lot of veterans here, so of the Von Kármán lecture series. Okay.
Yeah, I have some questions about the spectral radiometers. Can you tell us what frequency bands you're observing in, what sort of frequency resolution you have, what sort of viewing geometry you have, what sort of molecules have spectral features in the bands that you'll be observing?
You're talking about the spectrometers for the ultraviolet spectrometer?
No, the microwave spectral radiometers.
Oh, the microwave, okay. I can't tell you the six different frequencies. I know they're gigahertz. I'd have to look up what the specific six frequencies are, but they picked those six because you can characterize water and ammonia in the clouds and how deep, depending on how deep they are. The longest frequency can get down to about 1,000 bars, 1,000 times the pressure here on the Earth. So I can't fully answer your question, but I could look it up and get back to you on that.
Yeah, thank you.
You can see me after the talk and I can make sure to answer your question.
I was wondering where the spacecraft's being built, and if we get a tour of JPL or other people get a tour of JPL, if we can actually see it being built, like in any of our facilities or anything like that.
Okay, pieces of the Juno mission were built at JPL. The microwave radiometer instrument was built here at JPL, and the telecom subsystem, including, I showed you the height. Let me go back here and I'll point out the pieces of the spacecraft. So the telecom subsystem, including the high-gain antenna and all the electronics, the low-gain antenna and the medium-gain antenna were all built here at JPL. The entire spacecraft is being integrated and tested at Lockheed Martin in Denver. So all these pieces were shipped there. And, of course, Lockheed built the main structure, the solar arrays, and a lot of the other the star trackers and things like that. They're integrating them there and testing them. So my understanding, though, is on the website that I referred to is that there'll be a link which has some webcam attached to that, and you'll be able to see as the events are happening, and they have pictures from each one of those pieces. So here at JPL, we have to look at the webcam and see the pictures there, unless you're fortunate enough to head out to Denver and you can see it assembled. Now, after April 2011, though, they'll ship it down to the Cape to get it ready for the launch between April and August. Yes, sir?
I have two questions. The first is the water that you expect to be there, are you really sure it's there, or is it just models say it, and is that just a small fraction, just a trace amount of water? And the other question is, If you could say a little bit more about how, why you have that initial 100 day plus orbit before you go into the lower orbits.
Okay, let me tackle the water question first. In terms of the amount of water there, it's likely, again, I say likely because Juno needs to go there to find out where the water actually is, but it would be water vapor clouds and ammonia clouds, and they would be at different heights down inside the atmosphere. And that's a big question. How much water is at Jupiter? From observations of the sun and, of course, the Earth and comets and Mars and other bodies, they know how much water is much better than we know at Jupiter. And so knowing how much water is at Jupiter with all of Jupiter's mass is a big piece of that puzzle about where the water is in the solar system. And that's why it's so important to find out. It is a big mystery. Then the second question, if I remember it correctly, is why do we go into the large orbit initially? The large orbit, there's an interesting story about this. I'm glad you asked that question. When we first proposed the mission, we did not have this large orbit in there. The mission designers, we said, we'll just do it as simple as possible, and we're going to do a big burn here close to Jupiter, and we'll go straight into these 11-day orbits. Then we realized that just like the Galileo mission, which went into a long orbit, you actually save propellant if you go into this bigger orbit, and then you break it up into two pieces, and then you go into the 11-day orbit. And the reason that is because when you have a long burn of the main engine and you're close to Jupiter, the start and end of the burn is not the most efficient place to do it. You actually want to do it instantaneously at the closest point. And when you have to spread that out over time, it gets less and less efficient. And so if you do it in one big burn, it's less efficient than if you break it up into two smaller burns. And so in order to do that, we saved many kilograms. I believe it was around 100 kilograms of propellant to break it up like that. Plus, a bonus is that after you do that burn, you can then characterize when you're in orbit about Jupiter, what is that environment like? What's the spacecraft like? You can plan for the next events. And so operationally, it's a good thing to do too, because you have a little bit of breathing room before you're down in the 11-day orbit. Yes.
I saw Jupiter last night in a telescope. It was really cool. I saw the moons. But my question is, if you're on any of the orbits and you happen to come around a moon, would you do any research to those, just like a little scan or something or something?
Good question. One of the things that you can't see, let me point out something here on this picture. These are the orbits of the Galilean satellites. This is actually Callisto's orbit here. And it looks like, when you look at this, that we're pretty close to some of those moons as the orbits go along. But that's really, it's an artificial, it has to do with the projection here. The satellite itself, in this case Callisto, is nowhere close to where we are when Juno's in orbit. So they're hundreds of thousands of kilometers apart. Now that said, I'm sure that once Juno's in orbit around there, that they'll find a way to take a few pictures of some of the Galilean satellites. Right now, it's not planned to do that. As the mission progresses, there'll probably be some times where the satellite will be in the right place, and they'll take a picture. But it hasn't planned to do that. But that's a very good question.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Cool. Quick two questions. Why no probes? And also, will solar power be enough? I mean, you know, we haven't tested a lot of solar panels, you know, being way out there. I mean, would that be enough power, or are your instruments not really big energy hogs and they can operate without that much power?
Okay, let me tackle the probe one first. originally, there's another background story here to tell too. Originally, NASA said in this competition that Juno was part of the New Frontiers competition that the next mission to Jupiter should carry probes. And in the early part of Juno, we looked at probes versus looking globally at with the microwave radiometer and the other instruments. And it turned out that in this competition, you couldn't do both. There's not enough money in the budget to do both. And so if you carry probes, even if it's three probes, you're still going to be sending those to three different places. And the Galileo experience said that, well, okay, then we would have four different places we're looking at. It's better to, when we don't know these basic properties about Jupiter, to look across the whole globe. And the microwave radiometer can go deeper than a probe can go by a long ways, because we're not, a probe that goes down into the atmosphere is quickly crushed by the pressure, or and it gets too hot, it burns up the electronics. So it turns out it's better. Now, follow-on missions, it would be good to send a probe in, because when Juno, let's say you're asking me this question in 2017 or 2018, there'll be results back and there'll be intriguing things that come out of that. And you say, well, we'd want to send a probe to that place because it has some anomaly, or it looks different or something like
so
that.
So essentially the instruments are good enough to be able to probe deep through the atmosphere.
They go very deep,
and
yes.
You don't need that.
They go much, they go 10 to 100 times deeper than a probe can go,
right.
Probably. Cool. Now I'm trying to remember the second question.
Oh, about the solar
power. Oh, the solar power. Is it enough? There was, even from 2003, 2004, there's been a lot of testing on the solar cells and the solar arrays, testing for radiation and testing in the conditions in the, because it gets very cold out of Jupiter, and also in the dim photon, the sunlight that is hitting the solar arrays. And so they test in those conditions here on Earth to ensure that once they're out at Jupiter, they're going to function the way we think they are. And so those tests have retested again, and they're confident that, yes, those solar arrays will produce that amount of power. Even that said, they're in the operations, they take into account, well, what if the power is slightly less, and what could we turn off and if we needed to during the mission? And so that's also in the planning part of it. And so with all that contingency planning, it'll work.
Well, and with the strong magnetic fields at Jupiter, the solar panels wouldn't be affected at all, right?
They're not affected. However, some of the instruments and sensors are affected by the magnetic field. The magnetic field that when we're at the closest point is about 16 times the magnetic field, 16 to 20 times the magnetic field here at the Earth. And those were again tested in that magnetic field, even tested simulating the spin of the spacecraft to make sure that they're all going to function the way they need to. Or if they're not functioning exactly the way we think, can we account for that once we're at Jupiter?
Cool. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I guess the satellite's coming close to Ganymede, is it not?
Not very close. I didn't say this in the talk, but I would like to take for a year, I'd like to take the Galilean satellites and set them aside just for a year, and then I'd put them back.
For a different satellite.
But yeah. It's not coming very close. It's hundreds of thousands of kilometers away at the closest point.
I was hoping they would do something like they did for Titan, having a
oh, the flyby with
something.
Cassini when they do the close flybys. No, the orbit is such that we never get close to the Galilean satellites, and that's a good thing for Juno, because if we did close flybys, it would change the orbit in a bad way. It would actually make the mission shorter, because the orbit would go down into the radiation regions quicker. So.
Let me see. The probe will disintegrate. My ears aren't too good, so I couldn't hear all of your talk. But the probe will disintegrate like
in
5,000 kilometers above the center of the planet.
Yes, it's going so fast that when it hits the upper reaches of of Jupiter's atmosphere, it'll break up, and that'll.
It won't go as far down as it did on the other one.
No, it won't. It won't go down very far. It's going so fast that it'll break up pretty much instantaneously in the atmosphere of Jupiter.
Okay.
So what are some of the leading theories as to what causes such an intense magnetic field around Jupiter? I know that, I mean, with the Earth, it's just the spinning of the iron core, right?
Right. I'm going to skate out on some thin ice here because I'm not one of the scientists that modeled that. But but again, after the talk, I could try and connect you up, or we could answer some of those questions. But there's different. If there's metallic hydrogen down there, of course, metallic hydrogen has a property that the electrons move around pretty freely. And so if you're spinning, then that could create a situation where big currents are moving around. Because there have to be big currents of electrons moving underneath there. It's just a question of how are those generated and how deep are they? Are they up towards the top? Are they down towards the core? It's really unknown about that, but there has to be electrons moving around pretty quickly inside Jupiter. That didn't fully answer your question, but there's different, according to the different models, I think there's three or four different competing models of what a gaseous giant planet looks like in the interior, and each one of those models, the solar system would have to be formed and evolved differently for each one of those models. So if you can figure out what the interior looks like, what's creating those electron currents, that will say give clues as to how the solar system forms. So it all forms pieces of that puzzle.
Thank you.
Oh, here's some. I forgot there were questions coming in from. Okay, I'll read the. How does the first question? How do we shield the parts? I think that question is referring to the vault that I talked about in the center. It's like a rectangular box, and each face of the box is titanium, and the titanium is about two centimeters thick or so, and it's mostly solid titanium, although it's kind of a sandwich, but that's why it's so heavy, is because if you've ever taken titanium, and if it's solid, it's very heavy and dense, and that's why it's such a good shield, because particles that come in there, they don't make it through the titanium, or if they do, they're reduced in their in the damage that's caused. The second question is, what is the speed range of the wind on Jupiter? Well, I can tell you what the top end of it is. It's around the 300 miles per hour or so. And they, as just even from Earth observations, let me go back to a slide that shows, I can show the animation here right here. The winds on there, you can tell that the Jupiter, the core, is rotating every 10 hours, and then you can measure as the different layers move, are those different than the 10 hours or not? And you can take the difference, and that's where they get the 300 miles per hour. Now, that's in the different parts that are moving the fastest. Other places up here, like I showed at the pole, doesn't seem to be moving very fast at all. So I don't know what the lower end of that is, but it's got to be much less than 300 miles per hour. And you know, why are all these different wind speeds there? Then another question, do the magnetic sensors use the Hall effect or another technology? A partial answer to this, on the magnetometer, it senses both the magnitude of the magnetic field and the direction. So there's two types of sensors in the magnetometer. One of the sensors, of course, all magnetometers, in order to sense the magnetic field, they have a lot of wire that's wound around a core, because when you're trying to sense a magnetic field, what that does is it changes the wires in that wound core. The electrons move, and then you sense that, and that's just the basic technology of a magnetometer. The other part that's really important for the magnetometers to know where it is in space, so it has a set of star trackers that are very precise that are right next to the sensor, and they look out at the stars, and you can determine in three-dimensional space where you're at, because you need to know very precisely where those magnetometer measurements were in space in order to reconstruct the models. So they don't use the Hall effect, to the best of my knowledge. What is the response time for controlling the spacecraft if there's an unexpected event? Of course, Jupiter is the closest that it gets. It takes the speed of light, or when we're communicating with it, it takes about 30 minutes. The furthest point, when the Earth is on the other side of the Sun from Jupiter, it's up to about 52 minutes. So the response time for controlling the spacecraft, you have to plan that the spacecraft takes care of its own unexpected events, because those light times, let's say it's an hour, and then by the time you make a decision on the ground to do something, that can be another hours or days. The spacecraft goes into a safe mode. Remember, I mentioned that it's spinning, so it's a gigantic gyroscope. So if some unexpected event happens, it's not going to go tumbling or anything. It's just going to keep spinning at 2 RPM, and then the operations team on the ground can figure out how best to respond to it. So it goes into a safe mode, and that's the main thing that happens in an unexpected event. And the operations is planning that you would expect that there's going to be some unexpected events because we're going to Jupiter in places that have never been explored before. And the last one here from Ustream is, why does the cyclone wind on Jupiter not slow down? And that's one of the puzzles, particularly in storms. I mean, Galileo saw the Great Red Spot, and it looked essentially the same that it does today. Many of you have probably read about some smaller storms that get swallowed up sometimes into the Red Spot, or they swallow each other up, or sometimes they don't. That's a big mystery. What's causing that? Something down in the interior has to be providing energy to these storms, because that's what storms are. There's an energy source, and it keeps them going. And this one's been going for 400 years that we know of. Good question. I don't know the answer. And Juno will understand how far down the clouds go and give some clues as to why those storms are still raging there. Yes, sir.
Will Juno be able to resolve why we have the belts and zones and why they maintain their integrity, and also the complex photochemistry of that? Will it be able to start to approach an understanding of that?
Yes, the instruments, the microwave radiometer and chiefly the microwave radiometer will determine how far down those belts and zones go. All of the instruments will be trained on the different belts and zones to figure out what they are, how far down some of the cloud layers are, and what's in those cloud layers. Water and ammonia are but there's other parts of it too that could be there.
Thank you.
Well, I think we've run out of questions for now. I'll be happy to stick around and answer some other questions, too. Thank you very much.